Good evening. I'm Amna Nawaz in Washington.
And I'm Judy Woodruff in New Hampshire. On the NewsHour tonight, we are on the ground in the Granite State, where voters in the nation's first primary will help shape the Democratic race for president.
Then, a Justice Department at war with itself. Mass resignations from the prosecution team in the case against Roger Stone, confidant of President Trump and convicted felon. And cleansing the sacred water on the banks of India's Ganga River, where the holy waters grow more polluted every day.
By far the most toxic pollution of this river is probably the least visible unless you happen upon drainage canals like this one.
All that and more on tonight's PBS NewsHour.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
On an American Cruise Lines journey along the Columbia and Snake Rivers, travelers retrace the route forged by Lewis and Clark more than 200 years ago. American Cruise Lines' fleet of Victorian-style paddlewheelers and modern riverboats travels through American landscapes to historic landmarks where you can experience local customs and cuisine. American Cruise Lines, proud sponsor of PBS NewsHour.
Consumer Cellular offers no-contract wireless plans that are designed to help you do more of the things you enjoy. Whether you're a talker, texter, browser, photographer, or a bit of everything, our U.S.-based customer service team is here to find a plan that fits you. To learn more, go to consumercellular.tv.
BNSF Railway. Colette. Fidelity Investments.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, fostering informed and engaged communities. More at kf.org.
And with the ongoing support of these institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
The voting has ended here in New Hampshire, and results in the first primaries of this presidential election are coming in. Among Democrats, with almost a quarter of the precincts now reporting, Bernie Sanders is in the lead, followed by Pete Buttigieg by a few points and Amy Klobuchar in third place. Elizabeth Warren and Joe Biden are well back. Meantime, in the Republican primary, no surprise, President Donald Trump has already been declared the winner. But there is already a reshaping of the Democratic race. Two of the Democratic candidates have already announced tonight. Within the hour, they are dropping out. They are Colorado Senator Michael Bennett and entrepreneur Andrew Yang. Let's hear what both of them had to say, beginning with Andrew Yang.
We highlighted the real problems in our communities as our economy is being transformed before our eyes by technology and automation. And Americans know now that when you go to a factory in Michigan, you do not find wall-to-wall immigrants doing work. You find wall-to-wall robot arms and machines doing the work that people used to do. I am not someone who wants to accept donations and support in a race that we will not win. And so tonight, I am announcing I am suspending my campaign for president.
We love you, Andrew!
Thank you. I love you, too. Thank you, Andrew.
And the other dropout announcement we've already heard again within just the last few minutes is Colorado Senator Michael Bennett.
I feel nothing but joy tonight as we conclude this particular campaign and this particular chapter. I am going to do absolutely everything I can do as one human being to make sure that Donald Trump is a one-term president.
So the race already changing rapidly as these results come in. And tonight I'm joined by Amna Nawaz in Washington, where our NewsHour colleagues are watching these results closely come in as well. Amna.
That's right, Judy. While most of the attention is on the Democratic race, unsurprisingly, we can now declare President Donald Trump the winner in the Republican primary. with looks like just over a quarter of the votes now reporting in there. You see 85% of those votes going to President Trump. Judy, back to you.
Thank you, Amna. And I am here now in Manchester with Lucas Meyer. He is a strategist for a number of Democratic campaigns here in New Hampshire. He's also president of the state's Young Democrats. Lucas Meyer, welcome to the NewsHour and our special coverage. Surprises tonight. Yes, Bernie Sanders is in the lead, but followed closely by Pete Buttigieg. What do you make of that?
Yeah, certainly a really exciting night here in New Hampshire. You know, Pete Buttigieg came into this campaign a relative unknown, unless you're a deep party insider like me who was following the DNC chairman race a couple years ago. You had no idea who the mayor of South Bend, Indiana was. So to see him make these gains and then see Senator Klobuchar make a really late push and really, you know, a lot of the operatives in the state sort of maybe thought it was a little phony. We weren't sure if the surge was real, but it is certainly real. And we'll see if she can carry it out of New Hampshire across the rest of the country.
And see what she does with it. So at this point, and again, only a quarter of the results in, but that's what we see. But the other dramatic story tonight is Joe Biden. At this point, he's coming in fifth behind Elizabeth Warren, both of them well back from the top three. Joe Biden left the state.
Yeah, no, it was definitely unexpected. Vice President Biden was leading in the polls up until just a couple weeks ago, had a robust campaign in the state, was in the state early. So to see him leave before even the results had come was certainly surprising. And to see him lead off the debate on Friday night was certainly surprising, hearing him say that he had sort of conceded the state to a degree.
There's been a lot of discussion, Lucas Meyer, about the struggles that New Hampshire voters have had making up their minds. And part of that is because there's so many candidates, mm-hmm. so many more than we've seen in the past. But why is that? How are we seeing that?
Yeah, I think this is emblematic of the primary here in New Hampshire and the voters of New Hampshire really taking their role as the first in the nation state really seriously and really not wanting to rush that decision. I mean, even this morning around town, you talk to folks and they still haven't made up their mind yet. And I don't think a lot of people really believe that folks were going to take that long to make up their mind with all these campaigns and all this information and all these events, all this access. But it really played out. And I think certainly Senator Klobuchar's result really is emblematic of that, where the debate performance coming out of Iowa,
right.
I think you probably saw a lot of support for Senator Warren cut to Senator Klobuchar. So definitely not a boring night here.
And Iowa, it was said right after the Iowa results, which of course were mishandled, or at least the count didn't come in as it should have on time. It took days before we really knew what had happened. But there does seem to be a reaction to Iowa in that, again, Biden did not do as well as expected there. Klobuchar did better than expected.
Yeah, coming out of Iowa, I think, one, I feel for, as an operative, I feel for those campaign staffers in Iowa, having spent a year working on the ground and then to sort of not have that finality come in the caucuses last week. But I do think some of that uncertainty coming out of Iowa really forced New Hampshire voters to take a step back and really, I think, reanalyze their support for some candidates, which is maybe why we're seeing some of the volatility, seeing, you know, Mayor Buttigieg really uptight with Senator Sanders, who,
yes,
I mean, he had a really tough standard to uphold from 2016 to this year, so I think it was fascinating.
Bernie Sanders won New Hampshire 4 years ago by 22 points. Now, granted, his main opponent was Hillary Clinton. It was mainly the two of them.
Mm-hmm.
And this time he will argue, he's been arguing, I talked to him this morning, mm-hmm. a lot more candidates in the race, but this appears to be, at this point, a tighter margin. I also quickly want to ask you about the Republicans in the state. No surprise, President Trump, the winner of that primary. Republicans do seem united behind the president.
They certainly do, even regardless of Governor Wells' efforts in the state, which I was kind of surprised he got as many percentage points as he did, you know, honorable effort. There certainly are a lot of, moderate Republicans in the state looking for an alternative. And I think that dynamic as we head into the general election, as a Democratic Party coalesces around our nominee, I think some of those decisions by those moderate voters is going to play a really big role in November.
Really, really in it. Again, Bill Weld was the president's only opponent, governor of your neighboring state,
mm-hmm.
Massachusetts. Lucas Meyer, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
We appreciate it. And Amna, back to you.
Thanks, Judy. Let's take a closer look now at the state of the race in New Hampshire right now. This is so far with just over 31% of those votes in right now. It's still very early, but as we mentioned before, Senator Sanders has that early lead with over 27% of the vote so far. Pete Buttigieg coming in second with just over 23%, and Senator Amy Klobuchar there in third place with over 19% of those early votes. Again, just over 31% of votes in so far. We're going to keep up with those results as they come in, of course. But for now, we want to go live to Lisa Desjardins. She has been on the ground in Manchester following these results as they come in at a Bernie Sanders campaign event there. Lisa, no surprise so far in some regards, right? This is Senator Sanders' backyard. What's the feeling right there as these early results are coming in and showing him with a bit of a lead?
I think you can hear what the sentiment is here. We have a lot of chants from Bernie Sanders supporters basically saying that they believe anything is possible for this campaign. Changing the world is possible is part of their chant. For Bernie Sanders, he had a massive get out the vote campaign just on Saturday alone of this week. His campaign says they knocked on 20% of the doors in this state. They're reaping the benefits from that, it looks like, in these early results here in New Hampshire.
Lisa, I want to walk you through a little bit more of what we know from some of the votes that have been coming in New Hampshire as a result of some voter surveys. We can kind of break it down by age to see how people are breaking for which candidates. When you look at those younger demographics, these are voters age 18 to 29. Senator Sanders there with a clear lead, 49% of those younger votes. As we make our way up through the age brackets, you see among voters 30 to 44. Again, Senator Sanders has a lead there, 43%, the next closest candidate, Mayor Pete Buttigieg with 19%. Older voters still there, you start to see them break for Mayor Pete Buttigieg, 26% of those voters aged 45 to 64. And then when you go up to the next age bracket, that is voters over the age of 65, Senator Amy Klobuchar seems to be in the lead there with 23% of those votes. Lisa, based on what you're hearing on the ground, the voters you've been talking to there in New Hampshire, does that track that age breakdown with the candidates?
Oh, 100%. I kept a track of all these undecided voters in the state. I finally got responses from all of them, Amna. And it does seem that it is the younger undecided voters that were going for Bernie Sanders. Those who are parents, those who are grandparents, they were split between Elizabeth Warren, Amy Klobuchar, and Pete Buttigieg, those that I spoke to. But this is a challenge for Bernie Sanders as he goes forward. His coalition is young in these states. He's also won with communities of color. But the young do not always turn out in November. It's something his campaign will think about. Also, Amna, some news from the Amy Klobuchar campaign to me. They tell me that they are now ramping up their staff in Nevada. They plan to have 50 staff members there in the next few days. And listen to this, Amna, they are spending a seven-figure amount. They didn't give me the exact amount. Seven figures on a TV ad buy for Amy Klobuchar in Nevada. That is a massive amount for her campaign, which has run on a very limited amount of money. One sign that competitors are nervous about Amy Klobuchar, Amna, a rival campaign, and I agreed to call them only that, a rival campaign texted me and said, Amy Klobuchar doesn't have the infrastructure. Amy Klobuchar hasn't been put under the microscope. They want us to ask questions about Amy Klobuchar. Clearly, they're concerned. The Klobuchar campaign answers by saying, hey, we've gotten this far on limited resources. We plan to go farther.
Amy Klobuchar clearly seizing the moment there and probably going to face some of the fire some of the others have as they have seen surges. Lisa, yeah. Before I let you go, is there any indication now that we have the news two more candidates are suspending their campaigns, Andrew Yang and Michael Bennett? Is there any indication of where their voters might go?
I don't think so. We have seen from a recent poll that Andrew Yang voters seem to be most loyal to him. And some 42% of them in a recent poll said they would not support any other Democratic nominee. That is much higher than any other candidate. So for Democrats, those are voters that they have to win back that are going to be harder for them to get than other candidates dropping out. One other note, Amna, Tom Steyer has announced he is not dropping out of this race. Of course, he has been running a very strong campaign in South Carolina. He wants to get there and be on the ballot there. So he's staying in the race. We know he's not dropping out at this point.
Lisa Desjardins reporting for us from a Bernie Sanders campaign event in Manchester, New Hampshire. Thanks, Lisa. Good to talk to you. We'll go back now to Judy Woodruff in New Hampshire.
Thank you, Amna. And for more analysis of the race here in New Hampshire, I am with our senior politics reporter, Dan Bush. Dan, we're listening to Lisa. We're hearing what the different campaigns are saying. You've also been looking at these interviews with voters, a so-called voter survey done by the Associated Press. We're all trying to figure out why voters have done what they've done and what might happen in the future. What are you seeing? I mean, in particular, everybody's been talking about the split between moderates, more moderate and more liberal voters among the Democrats.
That's the big story here, Judy. We're seeing that divide play out. And one thing that really jumps out when you look at these survey results among voters overall here in New Hampshire, just 43% said they'd be very satisfied if Bernie Sanders won the nomination. Just 39% said they'd be very satisfied if Pete Buttigieg won, who now, if the results hold, will come in second place. That very is critical, I think, because it speaks to energy and turnout in a general election. So we're seeing in these numbers, Democrats are still pretty hesitant about now in Iowa and New Hampshire who is finishing first and second so far.
So interesting, because we know the when I was looking at the same voter survey you were, and when Democrats were asked what is your overriding quality you want in a candidate, in a nominee, it's 92% said someone who can beat Donald Trump. That overrode policy differences, policy issues, and so forth. I'm curious about age and whether, you know, there was a lot of conversation about Bernie Sanders appealing to the young and the other candidates having a hard time with the young, and yet the older voters are the ones who turn out reliably in elections.
They do, and when you look at these numbers, you know, another interesting thing when we look at Buttigieg, who would be the youngest president ever if elected, it's no surprise that there are some young people who do support him, who do relate to him because of his age. But when you look at those older age brackets, there are a lot of older voters as well who don't see his, you know, relative inexperience on the national level compared to his rivals as an impediment. Yesterday, I spoke with voters at a Buttigieg rally, voters in their 60s, 70s, one gentleman in his 80s who said that he sees in Buttigieg his children. He wants the next generation to get a shot. So Buttigieg is right now getting support across the board, even though Sanders is still dominating with those younger voters.
And the last thing, and I think this is something that Lucas Meyer, the Democratic strategist, and I were speaking about, was late deciders. People have had a very hard time here in New Hampshire, a lot of them making up their minds. What is it, 35% made up their mind just in the last few days. They broke heavily for Buttigieg and Klobuchar.
They did, and I was hearing that from voters again and again in recent days here in New Hampshire. I spoke with one person just yesterday who said they're going to figure it out when they walk into the ballot box. You were hearing that a lot of indecision still. And if you look at the two sort of sides of the party, a lot of Warren and support and Sanders supporters who were undecided but only focus on them, a lot of Buttigieg, Biden, Klobuchar leaning voters who are only focused on that side. So there's not a lot of overlap.
Not a lot of overlap at all. Well, we're going to continue to go through these numbers. We do have a PBS special coming up in a few hours. But this is something that there are so many numbers to follow and so many candidates to follow at this hour. So we hope you'll follow the election results. We're going to be updating this program later if we have news. You can catch up on all the day's news later tonight on this PBS station with that special news hour following the New Hampshire primary results.
In the day's other news, the potential prison sentence for President Trump's friend and advisor Roger Stone has triggered an upheaval at the Justice Department. Four federal prosecutors resigned after the department criticized their call for a 7 to 9 year sentence as, quote, excessive and unwarranted. Stone was convicted of obstructing Congress and witness tampering in the Russia investigation. We'll take a closer look after the rest of today's headline. The president suggested today that the Pentagon may punish Army Lieutenant Colonel Alexander Vindman, a key impeachment witness against him. Vindman and his twin brother were ousted from the National Security Council staff last week. Mr. Trump also said he expects other departures from the White House. The World Health Organization warned today that China's coronavirus outbreak poses a very grave threat to the world. China reported new totals of more than 1,100 deaths and some 44,000 cases. In Geneva, the head of the WHO urged nations to get their health systems ready.
a virus can have more powerful consequences than any terrorist action. And that's true. And if the world doesn't want to wake up and consider this enemy virus as public enemy number one, I don't think we will learn from our lessons.
The agency also convened more than 400 scientists to focus on speeding up drug treatments for the virus. But officials said it could take 18 months before the first vaccine is ready. We'll have a report from Beijing later in the program. Thousands of Palestinians took to the streets in the West Bank and Gaza today, protesting against President Trump's Middle East peace plan. In downtown Ramallah, crowds waved flags and chanted against Mr. Trump. Outside a nearby Jewish settlement, Israeli forces fired tear gas at Palestinians throwing rocks. Meanwhile, Palestinian President Mahmoud Abbas went before the UN Security Council in New York and condemned the peace plan.
It leaves Palestine fragmented, without any control of our land, air, and sea. It would put an end to the question of Palestinian refugees. It means a rejection to all agreements and obligations to establish two states along the pre-1967 lines. This plan will not bring peace or stability, and therefore we will not accept this plan.
The Trump plan allows Israel to annex large parts of the West Bank, including Jewish settlements considered illegal by most of the world's governments. Back in this country, the defense has rested its case in Harvey Weinstein's rape trial in New York today. The Hollywood producer's lawyers opted not to have Weinstein testify, shielding him from a potentially aggressive cross-examination. Closing arguments are set for Thursday and Friday. Actor Jussie Smollett is facing new charges of allegedly staging an attack on himself last year. A grand jury in Chicago returned a six-count indictment today. It accuses Smollett of lying to police when he claimed he'd been the target of a racist and homophobic assault. The actor was originally charged with disorderly conduct, but that was later dropped. A federal judge in New York has cleared a major obstacle to T-Mobile's takeover of Sprint. Today's ruling rejects a lawsuit from 14 states, arguing the deal would mean less competition and higher phone bills. The merger totals $26.5 billion and would cut the number of major U.S. wireless carriers from 4 to 3. The deal still needs approval from another federal judge and a state board in California. The head of the Federal Reserve today reaffirmed that no additional interest rate cuts are in the works unless the economy suddenly sours. Jerome Powell told a House hearing that 3 rate cuts last year have helped growth and job creation.
As long as incoming information about the economy remains broadly consistent with this outlook, the current stance of monetary policy will likely remain appropriate. Of course, policy is not on a preset course. If developments emerge that cause a material reassessment of our outlook, we would respond accordingly.
During the hearing, President Trump again complained that the central bank should do more to spur the economy. He tweeted, quote, "The Fed rate is too high." Seattle is now the first American city to ban evicting people from their homes during the winter, between December and February. The city council adopted the ban last night in a bid to help low and moderate income tenants. Seattle has some of the nation's highest rents and widespread homelessness. The bill faces a possible veto by the mayor, plus a likely court challenge. And Wall Street had a relatively quiet day. The Dow Jones Industrial Average lost a fraction to close at 29,276. The NASDAQ rose 10 points, and the S&P 500 added 5. South Africa today celebrated the 30-year anniversary of Nelson Mandela's release from prison. He walked free in 1990 after 27 years behind bars under apartheid. Mandela led the fight to dismantle the racist system of oppression. In Cape Town today, a crowd gathered to honor Mandela at City Hall, where he first spoke after his release. Mandela ultimately won the Nobel Peace Prize and was elected president of South Africa. He died in 2013. South Africa is also in mourning today for musical great Joseph Shabalala, who passed away in Pretoria. He created the choral group Ladysmith Black Mambazo and led them to global fame and multiple Grammys over 5 decades. They collaborated with Paul Simon on the Graceland album in 1986 and performed together in Zimbabwe in 1987, with Shabalala singing the lead on a signature song.
She got diamonds on the soles of her shoes. Diamonds on the soles of her shoes. Diamonds on the soles of her shoes. Diamonds on the soles of his shoes, poor boy. Diamonds on the soles of his shoes.
Joseph Shabalala was 78 years old. And Grammy-winning jazz keyboardist Lyle Mays has died in Los Angeles after a long illness. He co-founded the Pat Metheny Group in the 1970s and also worked with the likes of Joni Mitchell and Earth, Wind & Fire. Lyle Mays was 66 years old. Still to come on the NewsHour, a new twist in the saga of convicted felon and friend of the president, Roger Stone. The view from Beijing as the death toll from coronavirus shows no signs of slowing. To The Hague, Sudan's former dictator will be handed over to the International Criminal Court, and much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.
Roger Stone is again at the center of controversy. This time, it's causing a shakeup at the Department of Justice. Stone is the sixth former associate of President Trump to be convicted on cases stemming from the Mueller investigation. Federal prosecutors recommended in a Monday night filing that Stone be sentenced to 7 to 9 years in prison for lying to Congress and witness tampering. But senior Justice Department officials intervened. John Yang explores how there is now a fight over how long Stone should spend in jail.
Amna, the new filing makes no recommendation for Stone's sentence, deferring to the judge in the case. It said the original 7 to 9 years could be considered excessive and unwarranted. The shift comes hours after a middle-of-the-night presidential tweet calling the original recommendation horrible and very unfair. Cannot allow this miscarriage of justice. Late today, the president said he had not intervened in the case.
No, I didn't speak to the judge. I'd be able to do it if I wanted. I have the absolute right to do it. I stay out of things to a degree that people wouldn't believe, but I didn't speak to him. I thought the recommendation was ridiculous. I thought the whole prosecution was ridiculous.
And now all four of the line prosecutors in the Stone case have quit the case, and at least one of them has quit his job entirely. Matt Zadoposky covers the Justice Department for The Washington Post, and he joins us now from their newsroom. Matt, we just heard the president say he had nothing to do with this. What's your reporting tell you about how this happened and what the sequence of events was?
Yeah, the Justice Department also denies that there was any contact between the White House and them in the last day or two when this all transpired. Here's our best understanding so far. In recent days, there had been great argument internally about what to do with the Stone sentencing recommendation, which kind of these line prosecutors, these guys who tried to withdraw from the case today, advocating for a guideline sentence, 7 to 9 years, and their supervisors pushing back. We don't know exactly why they were pushing back. I think it's fair to assume now that it was probably because of pressure from Justice Department leadership. What happens then is very unclear. The Justice Department claims that they were sort of blindsided by the recommendation that is filed. There's a lot of reason to be skeptical about that, given that they presumably would be engaged in discussions about what was about to be filed, but they claim they're blindsided by this 7 to 9 year recommendation that is filed yesterday. So then today, they say publicly, a senior Justice Department official says to a lot of reporters, hey, we're going to undo this. We were surprised by this recommendation and we're going to undo it. And as you just reported, that's exactly what they did. They didn't say specifically, we think it should be half of 7 to 9 years. We think it should be 3/4. They just said they think it should be less. But it's just a remarkable, a stunning rebuke of the career prosecutors who by that point had all moved to withdraw themselves from the case.
How unusual is the back and forth between the line prosecutors and the higher ups in the Justice Department over something like this? And how unusual is it to completely reverse the recommendation entirely?
Back and forth over a sentencing recommendation are not that unusual, and it is very typical for prosecutors to want to be aggressive, and either their bosses or even political leaders to say, well, I think you're, you know, taking this a little too personal, I think you're going a little too far. But that's not exactly what we seem to have here. Can't say that I've ever seen a case where the department has made a recommendation and then not 24 hours later reversed itself. That's just so unusual, and given that there was such debate, you would think that just Justice Department leaders would be paying close attention to what was filed and would want to sign off on what was about to be filed. So we still have a lot of questions there, but suffice it to say, this is all very unusual. While debate about what should be recommended is not unusual, we have something much more than that in this case.
And the line prosecutors, the prosecutors who know the details of the case, involved in it day to day, they're the assistant U.S. attorneys who appear in court as opposed to the U.S. attorney who sort of supervises the office. The four line attorneys in this case have now left the case, one of them quitting the Justice Department altogether. What's the message there? What do you make of that?
They have not given a reason for that, but again, the implication here seems clear. So it's only hours after the Justice Department says publicly it's going to reverse their recommendation that all this happens. And it's so unusual for prosecutors to withdraw from a case. When they do it, it's because they sort of can't ethically attach their name to filings in that case. People might remember you saw that in the Affordable Care Act case when attorneys at the Justice Department felt they couldn't get behind the Trump administration's position on that. You saw a kind of similar thing in the census case when career attorneys were replaced on that by the Justice Department after possibly voicing some objection. So that seems to be what you have here again. The career prosecutors, the guys who aren't politically appointed by President Trump, resigning from the case, one from the department entirely, one from his post in the DC U.S. Attorney's Office, after the department sort of undercut them and said, we're going in a different direction.
Matt Zapatosky of the Washington Post, thanks so much.
Thank you.
China continues to struggle against the viral outbreak of this new coronavirus and is only now starting to allow scientists and public health officials from the outside to assist its efforts. William Brangham takes a look at how the country is coping.
While the vast majority of infections and fatalities are centered in eastern central China, in Hubei province, this outbreak is increasingly being felt across China. For a look at how things are on the ground hundreds of miles from Hubei, I'm joined by David Rennie. He's the Beijing bureau chief for The Economist magazine. David, thank you very much for being here. Could you just give us a sense right now, what is it like in Beijing?
So today in Beijing, where I am, would normally be absolutely packed. It's the end of this very long extended Lunar New Year holiday. Literally millions of migrant workers are due to be coming back to the big city here from their homes in the countryside where they went to see their families. Factories should be starting up. Shops should be starting up. None of that is happening. It's still unbelievably quiet. This is a city of 22 million people and most small shops are closed. Restaurants are closed. The schools are closed. No parents will put their kids out in the playground or the park. It really is a ghost town, though it's a huge city. It's really extraordinary how this enormous city just feels completely, completely dead.
And I understand that people have basically been ordered to quarantine themselves inside their homes. How are people reacting to those kind of orders from the government?
So it's a mixed picture. If you're asking how do the Chinese take the idea of being told to stay home and effectively cancel the biggest holiday of the year. There's an amazing acceptance. I went into villages where, you know, a dozen or so people were literally locked in their bedrooms for the whole of the Chinese equivalent of kind of Christmas and Thanksgiving rolled into one, because they had come from jobs in Wuhan, the worst affected city, and so they were immediately just quarantined and told they couldn't even see their own families. That kind of quarantine, there is amazing acceptance. People use these propaganda phrases that you see on red banners hung around the street by the party, saying that this is a war, this is a people's war, a battle. And they really do feel, I think, like foot soldiers in that battle. That's one side of it. There is another side of it, which is how much people trust the government's assurances that this is under control and how they seem to have really covered this up for several weeks at the start, and has that made this a bigger crisis than it needed to be? That we're seeing a really tremendous, unusual amount of very political anger on Chinese social media.
And what about the economic impacts? We've seen some car manufacturers outside of China basically stop production because they're saying that they can't get parts from China. But I'm curious, how is the local economy in China holding up?
I think that it's the next couple of weeks that will tell us a tremendous amount about public morale inside China, because people are going to either not be able to come back to their jobs at all, or, you know, tens of millions of people were expecting to come back and pick up that job as a waiter or as a cleaner in an office building or working in an airport, but all the flights are cancelled, all the restaurants are closed, all the office buildings are telling people to work from home. So if you were counting on that income, it's not going to be there. Now, if that lasts a couple more weeks, if the infection numbers keep climbing, then that's going to become a really serious domestic issue. And in as much as big factories that are part of global supply chains are also not able to get up and running, what's at the moment a kind of Chinese domestic worry is very quickly going to become a worry for the whole of kind of global commerce.
What is your sense about how President Xi and the central government being perceived in this crisis? I mean, this obviously has to be an enormous test for them.
President Xi has been presented for the last several years as the supreme leader, the man with all of the wisdom to run this country. But right now, he's clearly the man on the hook. And we're seeing the propaganda machine pushing very much this familiar narrative that if there have been any mistakes made, it's because of bad apples at the local level who will be sort of rooted out by the central government's investigators and anti-corruption kind of detectives. And in the meantime, President Xi, as you say, has been touring hospitals and medical facilities here in Beijing. He was called the commander of the people's war against the epidemic today by the state media. They're very much presenting him as the kind of the general in charge. But there is that tremendous distrust of a lot of what the government is telling people. And people can see images, particularly from those worst affected areas like the city of Wuhan, where there are a lot of frightened, sick people who think they might have the virus. But when they get to hospitals, they're completely overwhelmed. A lot of doctors and nurses are getting sick. There just aren't the supplies. And so in as much as things are going wrong, and it's a massive challenge for any country, that is a very hard thing to manage if you are the team around President Xi, who've really presented him as this utterly infallible, benevolent kind of imperial figure. And that raises the stakes for him when a big crisis like this needs managing.
All right. David Rennie, Beijing Bureau Chief for The Economist. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Stay with us. Coming up on the NewsHour, how to clean a sacred waterway. The difficulty of washing away the pollution of India's Ganga River. The former president of Sudan is one step closer to facing justice for the most egregious of the crimes he allegedly committed. During the most violent of Omar al-Bashir's 30 years in power, Sudan descended into civil war. Now, as the government conducts peace talks with rebel leaders, they've agreed to send Bashir to trial.
For more than a decade, Omar al-Bashir has been wanted by the International Criminal Court on charges of war crimes, crimes against humanity, torture, rape, and genocide in the Darfur region. Today, Sudan's transitional government and rebel groups in Darfur announced the deposed leader will be handed over to the court at The Hague in the Netherlands.
We agreed on the appearance of those whose arrests have been ordered in front of the International Criminal Court. We cannot achieve justice unless we heal the wounds with justice itself. We cannot, under any condition, flee from facing these crimes against humanity and crimes of war.
Bashir has been jailed in Khartoum on corruption charges since mass protests and a military coup forced him from power last April. His 30-year regime was marked by war in Darfur that began in 2003 when rebels launched an insurgency. Bashir responded with a brutal crackdown that killed more than 300,000 people and forced some 2.5 million others from their homes. The ICC issued an arrest warrant for Bashir in 2009, its first for a sitting president. Another warrant came the following year. But for years, the Sudanese strongman continued to travel across Africa, dismissing the allegations as Western conspiracy. It remains unclear when Bashir will be handed over, but it would be only the second time a country has surrendered its head of state to face the ICC. The other, former Ivory Coast President Laurent Gbagbo, was acquitted last year of crimes against humanity.
And joining me now is Saleh Booker. He's the president and CEO of the Center for International Policy, a nonpartisan research and advocacy group. He has extensive experience advising U.S. government officials on Africa policy. Welcome back to the NewsHour.
Thank you for having me.
So just when we look at the timeline, Bashir was indicted by the ICC over a decade ago, ousted from power a year ago almost. Why is this happening now?
Well, initially, the transitional government thought
they could deal with this domestically within Sudan. But it's their negotiations with the rebels in Darfur and other southern regions that has led to this decision that they have to release him to the ICC. So it's the demands of the rebels that they're trying to end the civil wars that have made this happen. Many people forget Sudan, while it's overthrown Bashir, it has a transitional government, a hybrid military-civilian rule. It's still facing multiple civil wars, and it's serious about ending those civil wars. And the demands of the rebels are for justice, first and foremost, and that means making sure al-Bashir faces justice.
The decision to hand him over, some reporting, is sort of a reversal of the council's previous position, though. This was not something they were readily willing to offer. Is there a chance that it doesn't happen, that they decide not to send him through to the ICC?
There is that chance. And in fact, what they've said is that they intend to create some kind of special court in Sudan to try those alleged to have committed war crimes in Darfur and elsewhere during these civil wars, but that the pressure will continue to be there to release him to the International Criminal Court. And largely because Sudan, the justice system in Sudan, is not really able to handle this kind of trial impartially and fairly, largely because the justice system was just decimated during the 30-year dictatorship of al-Bashir.
And could there be other people in addition to Bashir who face charges in Sudan?
Well, there are three other Sudanese government officials and Janjaweed militia leaders who already have arrest warrants that have been issued by the ICC. So they too are wanted in The Hague.
It's worth remembering when those arrest warrants were issued by the ICC, Bashir became sort of a pariah, right? There are very few heads of state in other nations who would actually meet with him. What would this mean if he does go through to the ICC to face justice there for the place of Sudan in the rest of the world?
Well, I think it's very important for the rest of the world and for the rule of law and the international rule of law. When he had the arrest warrants issued in 2009, 2010, yes, he was to be a pariah, but in fact, many countries did receive him, not only in Africa, but the Middle East and Russia and China. And so I think finally facing justice in The Hague will show that countries have an obligation, particularly those that are signatories to the International Criminal Court, but also the UN Security Council and the UN system, to make sure those who face arrest warrants have their day in court in The Hague.
And what about for the country, how they perceive this trial? If he goes through to the ICC, if for some reason he is not convicted, there has been some criticism on how the court sees through some of those trials, does it undermine the same forces that ousted him from power in the first place?
There's that risk, but I think the evidence is overwhelming, and there's loads of evidence in terms of the crimes that he's charged with: genocide, war crimes, crimes against humanity. The investigations by others, NGOs, journalists, have all led and helped the ICC develop the case against him. They began investigating this case in 2005 and didn't issue the arrest warrants until 4 years later. So there's sufficient evidence, I think, to convict him, as well as his colleagues in the crimes that he committed.
What does all this mean for the people of Sudan? We mentioned, the hundreds of thousands who were killed at that time of war, the millions who were displaced. You mentioned the ongoing displacement and conflict. How does this all resolve for the future and stability of people there?
Well, Sudan is a big and important country. It used to be Africa's largest country until South Sudan split away in 2011. But it's an African country at the crossroads of the Middle East and Africa. It's a country that has seen a civilian uprising, nonviolent protests leading to democratic change, overthrowing a military dictatorship. Algeria is attempting to do the same, also after 30 years. So these are very important developments, but they need justice. They need to be able to demonstrate that those who are responsible for the massive and gross human rights abuses, for the destruction of the economy, for all the wars in the country, are held accountable. They need to end the wars, they need to restore the economy, and they need to show that they can deliver a democratic system. They have 2.5 years left in this interim period to prepare for the elections that will usher in a truly democratic government for the first time in over 3 decades.
It's a critical time for
Sudan. It is indeed.
And the world will be watching. Sally Booker of the Center for International Policy, always good to have you here.
Thank you so much.
The Ganga River, known as the Ganges under British rule, is one of the most revered waterways in the world and also one of the most polluted. It provides water for nearly 500 million people, more than any other river in the world, stretching from the foothills of the Himalayas to the Bay of Bengal. Special correspondent Fred Desem-Lazaro reports from Varanasi, India, on the latest efforts to help clean the river.
In Hinduism, the Ganges or Ganga is sacred, a river that has nourished an ancient civilization since its beginning. Today, the Ganges Basin, the river and its tributaries, takes in 11 states plus the capital region of Delhi. In all, some 400 million people on farms, in factories, and in households rely on it for life, livelihood, and spiritual sustenance. In the holy city of Varanasi, temples draw throngs of believers who float oil lamps and marigolds.
It's our faith that brings us here. It's like nectar to me.
They take ritual baths, dips, even small sips, while reciting prayers to heal the body, to cleanse the soul. Vishambarnath Mishra is an engineer by training. He also heads the 500-year-old Sankat Mochan Temple.
Whatever suffering we have, she used to just take away all the suffering.
So the river can be the source of happiness and contentment.
Definitely.
Many believers seek to have their ashes sprinkled in the river. Thousands of bodies are burned here. Many, however, are not fully cremated. These practices stress the river, but they are only a small part of what it endures.
By far the most toxic pollution of this river is probably the least visible unless you happen upon drainage canals like this one, which discharge millions of gallons every day of raw, untreated sewage.
Experts link pollution in the Ganga and other rivers to India's high rate of waterborne illnesses, which kill an estimated 1.5 million children each year. Researchers have also discovered the emergence of so-called superbugs in Ganges water samples, bacteria resistant to most commonly used antibiotics.
Ma Ganga.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi, devoutly Hindu and allied with Hindu nationalist groups, represents Varanasi in Parliament and has made the river's cleanup a signature issue for his government. In this video posted online by his office, Modi vows to jumpstart the effort, which has languished for decades.
Namami Gange.
The $3 billion cleanup program began in 2015, but Mishra, citing the continued pollution among other things, says it's shown little progress.
No, I think red tapism is the biggest cause for it.
Red tapism.
Definitely.
Pollution control officials in Varanasi say new capacity is coming online that will treat much of the daily effluent. But Rajiv Mishra, who heads the Prime Minister's National Clean Ganga Project, says there's no quick solution.
It's a very long-term thing. People always think that when it will be cleaned. I mean, that question has no meaning.
He says it will take years to bring together the competing interests and jurisdictions across an area 1.5 times the size of Texas. And while the public supports a cleanup, Mishra says many don't perceive a grave threat to a river that they feel can withstand anything.
People will say there can be some dirty things in the river, there may be some pollution, but river remains pure. So that's a strength as well as a challenge for us.
He says there needs to be a shift in perception and even in some rituals. Electric crematoria have been built as an alternative to the traditional and less efficient wood-burning pyres. And there also are smaller campaigns to raise public awareness, like one effort which recycles flowers. Directly or indirectly, tons of these chemically treated flowers find their way into the river. They are now turned into incense sticks, which are sold near the temples. However, the most effective way to cleanse the river, also the biggest challenge, would be to restore its natural flow. After dams, industrial and agricultural use, Mishra says there's a lot less water left for cities like Varanasi.
Imagine a person, if you take out 70%, 50% of the blood from someone's body, what will happen to it?
Restoring the river's natural flow will require sacrifice from all users, Mishra says. It's a political challenge that will become even more difficult given climate change. Himalayan glaciers that feed this region's major rivers are receding, rainy seasons are getting shorter, and dry spells longer. For now, Anurabha Ghosh, who heads a Delhi-based think tank, gives the government's effort a low grade.
You have a financing problem, you have a manpower problem, and most importantly, I would say, you still have a governance architecture problem. And if we don't fix those basic things, then you won't be able to truly transform. Because the idea was, if you can fix this, you know, which, because what happens with Ganga as a kind of also social resonance.
For now, many eyes are on Varanasi, from the prime minister to the canoeing balladeer who shuttles tourists along the Ganga. She is sacred, he sings. Stop throwing trash into her. For the PBS NewsHour, this is Fred DeSamlazaro in Varanasi, India.
And Fred's reporting is in partnership with the Undertold Stories Project at the University of St. Thomas in Minnesota. From Star Wars to 1970s TV shows, the promise of a bionic limb was always the stuff of science fiction. Now, it's real. From PBS station WGBH in Boston, Christina Quinn introduces us to a woman who's helping local researchers perfect the technology.
Morgan Stickney approaches physical therapy at Spalding Rehab like everything in life, with her eyes on the prize.
I like to treat PT and OT as if it's a workout, so I go down there and give it my all.
She's a pre-med student, an elite swimmer, and a one-time Olympic hopeful. But she has suffered for years from an extremely rare vascular disease that went undiagnosed. It restricts blood flow to lower limbs, resulting in brittle bones.
I was trying to take my classes on opioids because I was suffering in so much pain. All my bones in my feet were dying and I couldn't walk.
Facing amputation, she learned about an experimental surgery happening at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. The Ewing amputation, named after the first patient to undergo the procedure, reconnects the muscles and nerves that communicate with the brain. It's a major advancement compared to a standard amputation, which severs these connections, says surgeon Matthew Carty.
When a patient with a standard amputation thinks about moving their ankle, which is no longer there, for example, they only get half the information. And so the brain searches for a way to process that incomplete equation.
The Ewing amputation closes the loop. So when an amputee puts on a prosthetic limb, the brain knows exactly where that leg is because the muscles and nerves are still intact.
And the idea is that once they've healed, when they fire those muscles and think about moving their ankle, their body basically thinks it's moving a biological ankle still.
Carty is working with researchers at the MIT Media Lab who are developing what is essentially a bionic leg. And Stickney, who underwent a Ewing amputation a year and a half ago, is among the first to help MIT researchers test it out. She's moving a robotic ankle just by thinking about it.
Is that okay?
Yeah. It's a potential game changer for anyone who uses a prosthetic limb. But for Stickney, the immediate payoff of the surgery was being pain-free and returning to competitive swimming. Months after her amputation, Stickney won two national championships and was living in Colorado training for the 2020 Tokyo Paralympics. But a few months later, the rare vascular disease affected her other leg.
I was recovering in the cold tub and I got out and hopped three steps and my foot fractured.
Stickney has since become the first person to undergo a bilateral or double Ewing amputation. She's part of a small but growing group of pioneers helping perfect this new technology. In the meantime, though, she's already thinking about restarting her training regimen.
Nothing will stop me from getting in the pool. My goal is to go to the 2024 Paralympic Games. I'll be in a different classification this time, but that doesn't change anything. I'm going to be working just as hard in the pool, if not harder.
Proving loss can fuel one's competitive spirit. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Christina Quinn in Boston.
And that's the News Hour for now. Please join us right here starting at 11 p.m. Eastern for PBS's special live coverage of the primary. We'll have up-to-the-minute results and live streams of speeches online and on our social pages. Stay with us. I'm Judy Woodruff in New Hampshire.
And I'm Amna Nawaz in Washington. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, thank you. We'll see you soon.
Major funding for the PBS NewsHour has been provided by
Colette guides travelers to experience the world in more than 160 destinations across five travel styles, like small group explorations. Their inclusive tours feature local guides, cultural experiences, meals, and accommodations. Since 1918, Colette has guided travelers around the world. Learn more at colette.com/small group.
Fidelity Investments. American Cruise Lines. BNSF Railway. Consumer Cellular. Carnegie Corporation of New York, supporting innovations in education, democratic engagement, and the advancement of international peace and security at carnegie.org. And with the ongoing support of these individuals and institutions. This program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by contributions to your PBS station from viewers like you. Thank you.
You're watching PBS.